We know how Jared Kushner got his money for his big investment opportunity. He was flooded with cash from foreign sources, particularly Saudi Arabia. We know how seemingly corrupt every step of that process was. But there is a huge thing that we have not known from the very beginning of this. No matter how many times we've checked in on this story, we don't know what he's doing with the money until today. Because the New York Times is actually taking a microscope to his foreign business dealings, not just on the raising of the money, but of the investing of the money. And they've deemed these dealings, quote, unseen in scale and speed for a former White House advisor. And as you will find as we go through these, as suspicious as the raising of the money was, the spending of it, I think, deserves as much scrutiny. So in particular, the report from the New York Times, and you should read the entire thing, zeroes in on the money that was raised by Affinity Partners. That is Kushner's firm, whose investors are almost entirely from, as we've said, foreign countries. It's a $3 billion fund financed almost entirely from overseas investors with whom he worked when he served as a senior advisor in the Trump White House. He's taken money from government wealth funds in Saudi Arabia, Qatar, the United Arab Emirates, as well as from the founder of Foxconn, the Taiwan-based electronics manufacturer, whose role in the firm has not been previously disclosed. In total, just about 99% of the money placed with him by investors has come from foreign sources, which is like, that seems like that should be a headline. Like, is that the way that it has to be? That this guy has all these contacts when he's in the White House, raises tons of money, might be still connected to the next president. We're not supposed to think that that's weird, but let's dive into some more details. So they have the huge sum of money that they're investing, $3 billion. Now that's not $3 billion that Kushner gets directly, but he does get quite a bit of money. So his firm collects approximately $40 million a year in management fees from those investors, even before any share of profits earned on investments. And we don't know what that could look like in the end. He's made 10 investments to date, totaling $1.2 billion, many of them in countries, again, based abroad. He seems entirely disinterested in the United States when it comes to these investments. But anyway, here are some examples of those investments. So stakes in the Shlomo Group, an Israeli car leasing and financing company, Dubizzle Group, which is a hilarious name, a Dubai-based online real estate site, EGYM, a Munich-based electronic fitness company, Mosaic, a California-based solar lending site, Is He Not Merciful, and Zamp, an Abu Dhabi-backed fast food company that operates more than 1,000 restaurants in Brazil. And interestingly, that car leasing firm that we talked about is part owner of Israel's only domestic builder of warships, which puts him in business with executives who are also major shareholders in an Israeli military contractor whose vessels have been used in the war in Gaza, armed with American-made weapons, and might still receive more weapons if Donald Trump becomes president. This entire thing is like a tangled Pepe Silvia incestuous nest of corruption. And until the New York Times report, we knew about basically nothing of this. I'm glad that it's being reported on. I don't expect anything to be done as a result of this. Nothing that's been reported is objectively illegal. It's just incredibly questionable when you bear in mind that he made these connections in the White House and he could very well be back at the White House in like 9 months. Yaz, what do you make of all this?
Yeah, that is a scary thought that, you know, somebody like Trump who enabled Jared Kushner and, you know, is the one who really put him on a national spotlight, that he could be president again. And all of this has been going on while Trump was in the White House and now in the years after Trump has left the White House. So Jared Kushner has always been kind of shrouded in secrecy. It's easy to forget that he was a quote unquote, what they say, a former White House advisor. It's crazy because we never even knew what his voice sounded like until fairly recently. He was very quiet. He never made public statements. We never really knew exactly what he was up to, apart from the fact that, you know, he was in charge of all kinds of things, including peace in the Middle East, whatever that even means, or whatever that even would have looked like if Jared Kushner had done his job, which we know he didn't. And for as much as Republicans are trying to build this case against Hunter Biden and his shady business dealings and how those relate to his father, and they have all the red string everywhere trying to make connections that aren't there, they are shockingly quiet about Jared Kushner and his business ties to Donald Trump. But unfortunately, like you said, I think you're right. I don't think anything much will come from any of this. And that's sad because if anything, even if it is legal, everything that's been happening, it looks very bad. it speaks to a conflict of interest between Jared Kushner and the guy who might once again be president. And it's not ethical, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah. And so let's say he gets back into the White House. He could be Secretary of State. Trump just wants loyalists. His decisions in office, or Trump's decisions, knowing that his family has all of these investments in these different areas, is that not going to influence government policy? Like, I will remind you all that they claim that Biden got $5 million in a business deal, and for that he should be like at least taken out of the White House, if not executed. Meanwhile, Jared's just running around $40 million in management fees, profit sharing deals everywhere, and not supposed to be suspicious literally at all. I personally think that if you're going to claim to be anti-corruption, particularly families benefiting from their political connections, there is a case to be made, at least based on my knowledge. We should ask Michael Shore. Has any family member of a politician ever benefited financially as much as Jared Kushner, and still is benefiting to this day? Not that I know of. So anyway, in particular, when it's tied up, you know, with conflict and all that. Look, I will say, as critical as I am of Jared Kushner, and as you pointed out, he had a lot on his plate as a White House advisor. And much of it, I don't know what he did in those areas. I don't know what his qualifications were. At least when it came to peace in the Middle East, he does seem to, in hindsight, have really set the region on a course for stability. And conflict-free to this day, thank you, Jared Kushner, for all of the work that you did. But bear in mind, like, you know, he's going around talking about, like, you know, waterfront property in Gaza. Maybe he doesn't mind the chaos. Maybe peace in the Middle East wasn't the goal. Maybe getting a financial peace of some of the Middle East was the goal, actually.
John, are you saying that these billionaires are benefiting off of the destabilization of entire regions? Is that what you're trying to say?
I mean, that's only always
unfathomable. It's unfathomable
every time. Anyway, so look, we can't cover all of what was revealed in the New York Times. Definitely go take a look at the article available right now. When you click the join button and become a tier 2 member, you get access to all of our weekly top 10 lists. What are you waiting for?